Good day and welcome again to this video contribution in our channel Missionaries Histories in Papua New Guinea again on YouTube. And let me introduce our speaker and former New Guinea missionary for this chapter and contribution today, Professor Dr. Herwig Wagner. He served as a Lutheran missionary in Evangelical Lutheran Church of New Guinea, ELCONG, positioned at Sattelberg Circuit from 1961 through 1972, including his time as a lecturer at the Senior Flierl Seminary at Finchhafen and Logauing. As from 1972 onwards, he was a professor for missiology here at the Augustana Seminary in Neuendettelsau in the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Bavaria-Germany. His theme today is about a specific experience referring to a cargo cult movement in the vicinity of the Sattelberg area and circuit, which is a very historical site in the mission and church history of ELCONG and then ELC-PNG. One focus in his presentation today is the insight and experience how in the early 60s the role of an expatriate missionary did start to change significantly, as the ELCONG had been also formally inaugurated as a church a few years before, in 1956. We are eager and interested now very much to hear his story and get to know about his insights as a missionary and servant of God in Papua New Guinea.
The Finchhafen area, since the 1920 years, had seen quite a number of enthusiastic movements in various villages all over the region. Some were more spiritual. Most of them, however, were concerned about how to get access to money and material goods and to enjoy a better life. Because the followers practiced various kinds of ceremonies and rituals, these movements commonly are called cargo cults, or in Pidgin more correctly, as belong cargo. In the beginning of this 1960 years, I have been missionary of the Sattelberg Circuit of the Lutheran Church. It was in 65 that we heard rumors of a new kind of movement in the Dedua area. In our regular staff meeting at Sattelberg, of course, that was a matter of high concern, and we discussed what the circuit should do. Finally, the leaders decided to send the delegation to Dedua and find out what was really going on there. It was the circuit president Honeo, the late local circuit pastor, and two more elders who should go. When I said, "I too would like to go with the group," Honeo immediately replied, "No, you cannot go, you stay here." Not surprisingly, I was very disappointed with Honeo's refusal. When he noticed it, he tried to explain why he had reacted so abruptly. He said, "These ceremonies and rituals are secret. Only followers are to know about the details. You, Ufungsoan, you are a foreigner and a white man. You are not supposed to know anything about such rituals. If you came along with us, the cult leaders certainly would hide the whole story from us. Moreover, the followers then would blame you in case their ritual would fail and not bring the desired results. This is why you better stay home. Yet," he said, "I promise I will give you a detailed report of what we are going to see and hear there." All right, I was to stay at home. After a week or so, when the delegation returned from Dedua, Honno kept to what he has said. He wrote for me a detailed report of the meeting with the leader of the ritual and his followers at the Tetua village. This now is Honno's report as he wrote it. At the beginning of the meeting, somebody said a prayer. Then the leader of the movement got up and told the story. "I am from Bemarum," he said. "I am the headman of this ritual. I want that my country shall rise. This is what I am working for." It was when we prepared for the first election to the House of Parliament. That was about November 63. At that time, the Finschhafen Kiap came up to our village and said, "New Guinea, ask your own land, challenge it, and it will give you wealth." So he said. And I understood well. Aha, now is the time for New Guinea to rise. That is why he said, "Challenge your land." In the first election to the parliament, I gave my vote to Makiri, but he did not help us much. Then I began to listen to Sitoy, another candidate. Finally, Tsiru came to my village, and we combined our plans. He is my deputy now. And then he told an ancient story. Long, long ago, there was a giant snake living in our area. It had a huge body. Its tail was doubled, and it had also two heads. The people killed it and cut it to pieces. But because of that, arose a dreadful famine. When all food was eaten up, my grandfather took dog's teeth, put them in a clay pot, and dug a hole into the ground, buried the pots, and poured pig's blood over it. On the top of the grave, he planted taro and bananas. With this ritual, he stilled the famine, and everybody again had plenty to eat. Nobody anymore stayed hungry. Real life arose. Now at our times, white Kiaps and missionaries have plundered all our land, and again there is famine. Yet I will still the famine now, the same way as the ancestors did, and I shall bring forth life in abundance. We too have planted pots with some money into our land and poured pig's blood over it. And now New Guinea shall rise, and money as well as all kinds of goods will come to us. This is what Honio wrote down in his report after the delegation had returned from their visit to Tetua. In our next staff meeting at Sattelberg, Honio told us how they had reacted after said speech of the headman. They neither agreed to become members of the cult group, nor did they oppose the cult leader. They remained rather skeptical and told the people, "When you think the day of harvesting has come, then tell me, and we shall come to see and share your joy. We certainly will join you at this day." Yet the day of harvest did not come. The story, however, has not ended here. Before the people had unburied the planted pots to get the harvest, the Finschhafen Kiap had heard what was going on up there. With a number of policemen, he went up to the Dedwa village, called a big meeting of all followers. He scoffed at them and scolded them, dull and backward villagers. He ordered them to dig out the clay pots and uncovered what was left of their deposits. Dirty coins, covered in rust, and stinky, rotten dollar notes. That was all, nothing else. The people saw it, no fruits at all. The poor villagers had just waited there some few money. That was the very end of the detour riddle. Why did I keep this story in my living memory? It is not to shame the followers of the ritual. They were but marred and misled villagers. I am rather impressed by the wisdom and strength of President Honio and the circuit leaders, of how they coped with the situation when the headman disclosed the secret of the ritual. Neither they took part in it, nor did they directly oppose him. Knowing, however, how futile such a ritual of money-making was, they decided to wait for the believed day of harvesting. They knew it would not come, yet they hoped the people then would learn the very lesson that there is no way of money-making by means of rituals, nor obtaining cargo by any secret ceremony. Yet it was the white Kiab with his policemen who ended the so-called ripening of the fruits, and it was him to be blamed that the ritual failed. How right was Honio when he refused me to come along with them? How right was he when he said, "You as a white man must not intervene in the ritual. If you do, the followers would be assured that no foreigner be allowed to know the ritual. It is a secret and must remain a secret. Otherwise it will fail." And so it happened. Just as wise Honio had foreseen it, and for this reason, to my regret, had refused me to become an eyewitness of a money-making ritual. From this experience, I drew an important insight. Facing such a situation, it is the Guinea leaders who are the experts, who are to cope with it. An outsider, as I was, cannot really understand what is in the follower's mind. True, first, I was disappointed when I was excluded. Afterwards, however, I knew it was the right decision. It was for the local leaders to react, not for an expatriate. The more is this true today for the church as a whole.